Hello everyone! I am so thrilled we now have this relatively universal ROM programmer and all the progress we've made together. It is now an indispensable tool for so many people. First of all, I can't thank this community enough. Your enthusiasm and feedback are what makes this project so much more than I ever imagined. From retro computer enthusiasts to synth tinkerers and breadboard experimenters, hearing your stories and seeing how this little project is being used worldwide is what makes this project so much fun to work on. Now, onto the updates. If you've been following along, you'll know revision 2 of the programmer sold out almost immediately. With all the new interest came some fantastic new ideas, including a few I want to highlight today. A big shout out to Kuba0040, who noticed an issue with the feedback loop potentiometer on revision 2 and opened a GitHub issue. If the potentiometer is overturned, the wiper might lift and the regulator can enter a runaway condition. While this isn't usually a problem, it's still better to limit the maximum voltage. Connecting the bottom of the pot to the wiper fixes this and makes the design more robust. Since we were already discussing the feedback loop, the conversation naturally moved to how we can control the feedback voltage, and thereby the output voltage more precisely. I've always thought about adding a cheap R2R DAC, which uses a resistor ladder to convert digital signals to analog. While off-the-shelf I2C or SPI DACs exist, they often cost more than the entire board. That's not ideal for a budget-friendly open-source project. Instead, we explored using parallel registers, just like those already on the programmer, to build an 8-bit DAC. This approach is not only cost-effective, but also makes it possible to experiment with digitally controlling the programmer voltage. But we're still months away from that, so don't sit around waiting if you need a programmer today. On the back of the board, you'll see a few suspicious-looking solder jumper pads. They're there to make it easier to change the voltage regulator feedback loop, either for increasing the default voltage of about max 22 volts up to the 25 volts needed for TMS2532 style ROMs, or for experimenting with manipulating the voltage digitally. This isn't a change you'll see in the next few months. Digital control will likely take a few prototypes to perfect. The only difference all this new engineering makes is that you no longer have to adjust the programming voltage with a screwdriver. But for now, revision 2.1 is here and it's better than ever. If you need a programmer for old ROMs, this is the version to get. But that doesn't mean we shouldn't have some fun making the upgrade to digital. And of course, I wouldn't be able to keep making these revisions if JLC PCB didn't keep sponsoring them. If you haven't heard of JLC PCB before, they provide easy, affordable, and reliable PCB production and assembly solutions. Ordering fully assembled PCBs is super easy, and with a $30 coupon, you can get top quality 6-layer PCBs for just $5. And that's even with gold finish and via in pad without extra engineering fees. As always, I'm super happy with the quality of the boards, and with the speed of the assembly service and shipping, I have to admit it's hard imagining going back to soldering all the SMD components myself. Another minor update to revision 2.1 is the addition of a polyfuse on the programming voltage regulator input. I picked one with a maximum continuous current of 200 milliamps, which should be enough oomph to program any old ROM, and low enough that a direct short won't kill anything. Well, I wouldn't trust me on that, but I did test turning on the regulator straight to ground, and the fuse did its job and kept the smoke inside of things. I could have put it on the 5-volt rail itself, but generally I assume either an Arduino already has a fuse to protect from shorts, or whatever USB is powering it should be able to protect from a short. So this is more of a measure to protect the regulator and the ROM in the socket, even though the fuse will recover and keep pulsing whatever voltage the regulator is set for. I still can't guarantee you can plug in a ROM the wrong way and turn on 25 volts and it won't damage anything, but this will certainly help, even if it's not guaranteed to keep the magic smoke inside. And speaking of smoke, I want to give another shout out to Henrik Olsson, whose work on the Firestarter firmware and app has been instrumental in supporting even more ROM types. With his efforts, Firestarter now supports flash-based ROMs like the SST39SF series, bringing software write protection into the mix. And as you might have noticed, that means the 4 megabit SST39SF040 works perfectly. Even though commercial programmers like the TL8662 or the T48 exist, and might be faster for certain tasks, they can't compete on openness, repairability, and community support. Plus, if you break something, it's easy to fix. If you have ideas, feedback, or want to share your own projects, please come say hi in the Hackerspace Clubhouse on Discord. Let's keep building, experimenting, and bringing old tech back to life. Either way, thanks for watching. I'm looking for a